All right. My name is Bob Kane. I'm the head of the Lakeland Foundation. Believe it or not, what we do at the Lakeland Foundation is raise money. We go out and ask people for money. Generous people give us millions of dollars. Some of those dollars went to support this program today. So, thanks, as always, to these great donors that make a difference here. I was just in a committee meeting with a bunch of people from our board. Old people, young people, a pretty vast array. And I said, have you ever heard of Ted Ginn Jr.? And a couple of them raised their hand, and they knew this guy. And then I said, how about Ted Ginn Sr.? And everybody raised their hand. Now, what's cool about this is people recognize that a guy like this, not a football player, at least not now, can make this kind of difference in the world. It was fascinating to see, so congratulations. I also, want to bring up while I'm here that my mother went to Glenville High School, 1936. Can you imagine? 1936. And, I remember looking at pictures of the people in her class. I remember going down the streets, seeing the houses. She lived in several houses in Glenville. And I remember years later spending a lot of time on those streets when I was working in the city. Pretty amazing place. Even more amazing with what you've done there. Here's the simple message I want to leave you with. This is Lakeland Community College. For those of you who are students here, you know what an outstanding job we do of providing support to make sure that you succeed, to do everything possible for you to succeed in college. For those of you out there who are still in high school, who aren't ready to go to college yet, think about Lakeland. Think about what we have here. Think about the outstanding people we have who can support you and ensure that you overcome barriers and succeed against all odds. So with that, let's move on. Thanks.
My name is Carmelita Williams, and I'm a classmate of Coach Ginn's. I went to Glenville also, so there's tar blooders everywhere. And so I came up with this thought about a year ago, and I said, maybe I'll invite him here, see what the Men's Center think about bringing him here, so he can talk to some of the faculty and staff, and definitely to the students, and our student athletes in particular. So we mulled the idea around a little bit, me, Jim, Randy, Jeffries. And the more we talked about it, the more it starts to manifest. And he's here. So I appreciate all of you coming out, supporting this event. And definitely Bob Kane and the foundation, we really appreciate you with a special nod to Jen. The diversity committee was instrumental in this also, and we really appreciate them at the diversity committee also. And then all of you who showed up. So what I'm going to do now is I want to read a little bit about this young man here, Coach Ginn. And this is going to be like stories, that people who don't know him tell. Because I got some other stories. Trust me, I got some other stories. Okay, so Coach Ginn has served as a head football coach of Glenville Tar Blooders since 1997. His program, winning and building an A team against all odds, is nationally known. In 1997, under Coach Ginn's leadership, the Glenville High School football team became co-champs for the East Senate League. From 1997 to 2009, Coach Ginn led the Glenville Tar Blooders to 8 consecutive East Senate League wins. In 1999, Glenville became the first municipal school to reach the state playoffs and made 10 consecutive appearances from 2000 to 2010. Glenville was the first Cleveland Senate team to be ranked 4th in the Plain Dealers top 25 teams in 2000, 2nd in 2004, 1st in 2005 and 2008, and 2nd since then. Coach Ginn was also named head coach of the Glenville High School boys track team in 2003. He led the track team to 5 consecutive state championship titles from 2003 to 2007, and was considered one of the best track teams in the country in 2008 and 2004. Ted Ginn is the ultimate tar blooder, but will tell you that his program is neither about track nor football. He will tell you that it's about saving lives and saving souls. Football and track are just the vehicles we use to ride in. So without any further ado, I want to introduce to some and present to others Coach Ted Ginn Sr. Okay, so our format for tonight, and this was preferable by Coach Ginn, was just to have a conversation, for us to engage in a conversation with him, talk about some different questions that we might have. After his presentation, we will take a few questions from the audience, and then we'll do a presentation. Okay. So the first question I have is, everybody thinks that you're just about winning football games and championships. What do you have to say to those people?
Well, obviously, I'm a coach, so they would think that anyway. Excuse my voice, I was kind of ill a little bit this week. But I would think that they would think that that's what it's all about, because it's football and it's track. But those things are just, like I say, it's the vehicle that I use to ride in so that I can be able to engage with young people. It's an opportunity to help kids navigate through the world and be an advocate for kids. But the main thing is to make productive citizens in the world through sports and education by having the school. So that's just something that people always say. And then really, the sport really get in the way of the whole purpose.
Okay, secondly, the Plain Dealer published an article about you where you talked about the table. Can you tell us a little bit about the table?
Yes, the table. The table, you know, the world is in such a uproar today. And we sit around and we try to come up with different reasons of why we are having different trouble in the world. But just when I think back and go back to how I was raised back in the 50s and the 60s, the table is what's missing, meaning that the table was the information center in all of our homes, because the families are broken today. And we all are guilty today, even myself, of that table, because that's what we was raised at. The table, you could not negotiate the table. You had to be there at breakfast time, and you had to be there at a certain time at dinner. And at the head of the table was your parents, was your grandparent, was your mother, or your father. And it was giving you direction, and it was really educating you. And that's what's missing in the world. There's nobody sitting at the table. Everything is so fast, and everything is moving fast, and we're losing the whole core values of life. We talk about education, we talk about all these different things, but the major education was then, you know, at home. And we're dealing with that issue today. And like I said, we all guilty, because everybody get that grab bag and they go to their room and they watch an Empire and all these different stories. You know, they don't have time to sit down and tell your parent tell you, say, how was your day in school? Wow. What did you do today? You know, that was the information center.
Absolutely, I agree with that totally. Tell me what the term at risk means to you.
Well, you know, that's another word that I use a lot, that I hear a lot, and I'm quite sure that anybody knows what I do, that Coach Ginn has this school that is for at-risk boys and all those different things like that. That's not the reason why I use the word at risk. I use the word at risk because everybody in the world is at risk. for not reaching their full potential of life, no matter where you live, where you go, where you stay, or what color you are. You understand? I think that you know, and if you see how the world is today, it's, you know, just to look at the presidential thing. We at risk. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? You know, it's just so many things going on in the world that put us all at risk. Our kids are not being exposed to the basic wisdom, you know. I think we look at things like we only concentrate on math, science, social studies, and English, which is the curriculum. But we forget about the wisdom part. And that's the wisdom part that I was raised up on. And most of us was raised up with wisdom. And that's all part of everything that you do on a daily basis, and that put everybody at risk.
Okay. Can you talk about the Sports Illustrated article referencing your efforts to get one of your players, Pierre Woods in particular, signed, and what the subsequent Ginn rule being established?
Where did you dig that up?
Oh, I know.
A lot of people don't know that. That's that was years ago, back in 1999 or 2000, and that's another situation of just, you know, thinking about what I'm doing for children. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people in the world don't know that that's the Ginn rule. And if anybody dealing with sports today, they just came up with this rule now that you can't have satellite camps. Anybody know about that? You know, well, see, y'all don't know about that, but that's another rule the NCAA just came up with. But they came up with a rule because of me, too, back in 2000. I took Pierre all over the country, like 5,000 miles, got in a van, because major colleges wouldn't come to the inner city. So I got in, rented a van, and drove all over the country, took him to the schools and showcased him like that, and he ended up getting a scholarship to Michigan, not Ohio State. That was bad back then. How many Ohio State fans in here? Yeah. Yes, Dad. So, but he went to Michigan, and then there's a little bit about that story. You know, they didn't want a kid from the inner city at Ohio State, and Michigan took a chance. See, and then the NCAA came up with the rule where, because of that guy in Ohio taking that boy all over the country, we won't allow you to give scholarships at a camp. So you can't offer a kid a scholarship in a camp in the summertime, but you can take him around the corner at McDonald's, on the corner of McDonald's, and give him a scholarship. You just can't do it on the campus. So that's the Ted Ginn rule.
Ted Ginn rule. Okay. Why did you open the Ginn Academy, and how difficult was it to start your own school?
Well, I opened the Ginn Academy for all the reasons that we basically talked about before, the at-risk part, to be innovative and be different, mm-hmm. You know, to give each kid an individual life plan, you know, to sit down with the children, interview them, and know what their dreams and goals are. If they didn't have any, you give them some, you know. I just think, years ago, we didn't get all the information that we needed to make it, you know. So I was running a school inside of Glenville, mm-hmm. You understand, with my football team. So I took the same concept that I did with them. You know, I chart them every day with their attendance, with their behavior, and the academics. And I was setting their schedules and stuff in Glenville. I said, "Woo, this is good. You know, let me get me a school." And that's what I did. And you know, I didn't want sports, so we don't have sports at Ginn Academy. So, you know, it's just strictly educating them, giving the right information.
You mentioned one other thing too, when your students don't show up.
Oh, we go get them. No, and then we gonna call the house and say, and the mommy's sitting there saying, "Why you not out? Why you didn't come to school?" Well, then we get on the parent too.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, it's the same thing. You know, you're dealing with kids, and that has not been raised properly, and then you're dealing with kids, parents that hadn't been raised properly. So you got two issues there. So you got to learn how to deal with that. But it doesn't, but you know, we got some great kids too. You know, we got all issues all over the world, but we got, you know, we growing global leaders of the century now.
That's right.
Yeah.
With these skills and discipline and the love and everything that you show these athletes when you're working with them, how do you transition that over into their education and how they can use those same skills to be successful?
Well, that's what education is. You know, you are teaching the whole child, you know, because just like I told you before, nobody's sitting at the table. So, you know, they're not getting those things. Mm-hmm. So you got to set a table in your school. That's what the school is, a table. So you teaching all the core values, you teaching all that on top of the, what they call so-called the curriculum. Mm-hmm. But that with me, and I have teachers and you know, it's a crazy philosophy, but the teachers buys into it the same way. Mm-hmm. You know, the everything that I think that people think, what are your curriculum? Those are requirements for everybody in the world. Our curriculum is love, passion, and understanding. You got to give them love, you got to have the passion, and you got to give them a proper understanding and how to navigate through the world. You know, and that's what was taught to us as a child. You know, so it's all being able to influence. And that's the greatest thing in the world, being able to love them and to serve them. And if you don't have that in your heart, you shouldn't be in this business, you know?
What would you say to like some of the athletes here who maybe couldn't get a scholarship or couldn't go to a university about them making the choice to come to a community college and what that choice might mean to
them? Well, see, that's another thing. You can't, education is education. Don't matter where you go. You are the same guy if you're at Lakeland, if you're at Ohio State. Yeah. You're furthering your education. You are trying to make a difference in your life, and you're setting your brand of who you want to be as a man and to get a job. It doesn't matter. That's all a hoax. I don't deal with that like that. You know, every kid can be educated anywhere.
Yeah.
You know, go on the corner of the street, a bum can educate you. He'll teach you how not to be a bum.
That's right. One other question I have. Talk about young people winning against all odds, and what are some of the odds that our young people, particularly our young men, face?
Not only the young men, people, period. You know, we all facing a lot of different odds today. When I first started out, I think the motto was win against all. I was trying to win a football game. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I ended up having to take the whole family, had to take the whole city, and all the children, mm-hmm. and their parents. All those odds is against the society to me. You know, I think that we're losing the core values. So you have to teach that, mm-hmm. you know. It's so important to go to class, learn math, science, social studies, English, all that. But it's also important to have the wisdom that is missing in the world that we don't teach anymore. See, we think that we can go and put something on the board and say, learn this, but why? Mm-hmm. You understand? How do I take that and make it apply to my life? Yeah. You know, so you got to teach all that. So it's so bad. And I'm telling you, we can go anywhere in America, we can go anybody's community, and you talk to any kid, I guarantee you that kids all over the country, every community is trying to win against all odds. And I'm telling you, because they are missing something. You send your kid to school, you expect somebody to love your kid.
Yeah.
And you got people sitting there looking at it, nothing in my contract say I have to love a kid. I just got to teach them.
Yeah.
I'm just telling you. So that's hard right there. That's tough.
Okay, so I'm going to mention this story that I'm being forced to mention. But we're going to ask Coach Ginn about when he wanted my son to come and play for him.
You're finna start a problem.
who was attending Brush High School at the time, and he had opportunity to see my son play football, and he came to me and, you know, as a classmate, and said, look, you know, you need to let me have your son and let him come over here to Glenville, and I'll look out for him. You know, he's gonna stay with the athletes and all of that. And why he says that I said no.
Why?
Why do you say I said no?
Because you thought that Brush was a better educational system for your son. And I understand that, you know, because of the community, and you thought they can better educate him, but they didn't care about him as a person. It was personal to me. You my friend, that's your son. I'd take him as my son, you know, because the requirements are the same all over the world. And you'll find out as you go along that everybody only cares about their blue ribbon school. They don't care about the souls of the kid, you understand? And I struggle with that. And I struggle with all that. And at the end of the day, when that kid's heart is pricked and he don't understand, who are you gonna go to?
Yeah, that's true. Absolutely true. You know, I agree with that totally.
That's
one mistake I made in my life, okay?
That was a big one too.
So what we're gonna do now, I'm gonna come around and take some questions from the audience. So anyone who might be interested in asking Coach Ginn a question can raise your hand.
How you doing, Dave?
Yes. Good to be with you all over.
Been with Dave for 20 years. 30, yeah. Is it 30? Man, quit telling our age.
Thanks, sir. Thanks for coming out. Appreciate hearing everything you got to say. I was going to ask you about keys to success. What would you say, maybe three things that you feel like are really the keys to success?
The keys to success. You just talking about this, everything that I do. First of all, the first key is going to be the love. The second is the passion of it, you know, and just to know that God put me in a situation that I had to serve, you know what I'm saying? And I tell people this all the time, you know, just having faith. You know, if you just got a little faith, just a little bit, it's so big, man, you know. But the key to it is just having the love for what you do. And being able to serve is one of the greatest things in the world for me. That's the keys for me.
The focus on love and passion in schools, if that was applied to all inner city schools, how would that affect the homeless population or the disabled population in that area? How do you see that working in the school systems that are out there now?
Well, I just don't think it applies just to the city. I think it applies to every community in America. I think having love for education and love for children is huge. You know, we make it such a system, you know, numbers and all that kind of stuff. But you got to love some kids. The kids are human, you know what I'm saying? They're not a machine, they're not a computer. You know, kids love that attention. They love to know how much you care. And you can make them do anything, the worst of all of them. And I'm telling you, man. And you have to have passion. You have to show them. You know, when you talk to them, you see, kids are like little machines. You know, they looking to plug in. You know, they looking to plug in. When they plug in, they want to get a charge. You know, you drive around to these places, you see these new little stations in the parking lot, and they got where the car got to go plug in. We are little stations, you know, and kids are looking at you every day to plug in. They want to get a charge. You got a lot of people that's standing up in these little stations where they plug in, don't get nothing. You understand?
And they.
They need it, but it's not just them only. You got some kids that got everything. Yeah. They need that. That's something that simple. It's simple to me, but some people say, oh, you don't need that. Yeah, a kid wants you to come in sometime and say, hey, how you feel today, son? You know, let's go out and throw the ball. Well, you know, I got business to do today, so I don't have time for that. You know, A kid will go up, and when he get 25 and he introduce himself to you, he said, "Dad, you remember, you never took no time with me." You understand? You know, see, all these things are basic things that we was raised up on. We never understood when grandmama said, "Keep on living, you'll know, you'll learn." You know what I'm saying? She tell you that. I said, "What are you talking about, grandma?" Now I know what she's talking about. You understand? Huh? I mean, it's just, we just get so commercialized in this system and all that. We need to break that up. We got to go back to the basics, man. You know, so, hey.
Yes, Mr. Ginn, I just want to know, how did you successfully change the culture inside of your school? Because working in a CMSD school, I understand that you have to change the culture to influence the curriculum and everything else, because if the culture isn't addressed, then you won't have success in other areas. So if you could kind of give me some ideas on that, I would truly appreciate it.
Well, let me tell you, first how I changed it, I had to be the example, and I walked through the school every day, 9 years ago, and just, and almost just poured it into them and wouldn't let it out. You know what I'm saying? But you got to be the example, and you got to show kids that you love them. And then you got to show them. You just can't talk and lecture the kids. You got to expose them to things, you know, because people talk so much hopelessness into our kids and into a system. That's like we, and I said, win against all, just like what you said, win against all odds. See, the odds say that you're not going to make it because you stay on St. Clair. You understand? And then you say, but there is some Saints on St. Clair. You understand? So I use every scheme in the world, man, to influence them. And then when they see some success, and you use all these different ingredients of love and passion and understanding and all the things, and then once they get into a kid, then they start saying, "Oh, I can be something, huh?" Yeah, but then you're fighting against the outside world, because as soon as they walk out that door, they're going back into reality, and then that's real. So you got to go the next day, you got to suit up again, because you got to fight against that. You understand? When it might be in their homes, it might be on the street, it might be the channel 8, channel 3, there's this negative stuff that they see. You know, you got your all type of things, and it's not just in the inner city. It's out here too. You understand? These kids are dealing with so many things that, because people are so busy making money and moving and whatever we can get over today, you know, because we concentrated on so much about being rich and wealthy. And we forget about our children. We forget about people, you know, but it takes somebody that be consistent. You have to be consistent in what you say, you know, and so many people that's not consistent, you know, and it's hard work. But in this thing, man, about educating, parenting, coaching, this is a dangerous business. And it's a dangerous business because of this. You're dealing with God's children. And we all forget about that. You understand? And if you don't treat God's children right, he's going to get you. That's biblical. You know what I'm saying? And if you don't have the love, the passion of a parent, of an educator, or a coach, you setting yourself up for a letdown. Because when your life changes, you look through your life and you say, "What did you do with my children?" And that's real talk. You're looking at somebody that can tell you that. Because I went through things, and I know why I went through them, because it looked like I was doing the right thing, but I had the wrong people around me. And I was the head. So God fixed me about that. I got to get rid of those people. So I can go on and on about a lot of things.
One other question I have for you too. Mm-hmm. Who were your mentors?
I'm going to first tell you my grandmother. I'm going to tell you that straight up. Everything I did was a sin, first of all. When I was a little boy, used to tear the dust out of my pants. So But, you know, I had several people. But my grandmother, I think, would be first for me because she taught me the core values of life, and she taught me in a way that I still use those things today, you know. Helped me to navigate through the world. And then we talking about back in the 60s. And I was a restless type kid that never thought like nobody else. And I came up through segregation time and didn't understand that. And I was bad. And I couldn't understand why I couldn't go to that swimming pool. You understand? And she would tell me the reason why. But I still didn't like that, you know? So we had to swim in the creeks and the ponds, and they had to go to the swimming pool. So I always wanted to go in that swimming pool. Now I won't go to a beach. I'm going to find me a pool. You know, but my grandmother was probably my best mentor.
Where did you grow up at?
In Louisiana.
Okay.
And then I came to Cleveland when I was 11, and that's when I met you and Hazel. Y'all helped me get through school.
You have a question?
Yes. I heard you talk about the table.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up at the table.
That's right.
When we was talking earlier, you was talking to one of my classmates about getting the dust beat off them overalls. Yes. I used to literally watch the dust come up because I was bad. And a lot of that stuff that you was talking about, I saw the segregation, the outright blatant segregation, as well as the more innuendo type. Mm-hmm. And it made me mad. Mm-hmm. And I lashed out, and it got me in a lot of trouble. So with that being said, with all this stuff that's going on now to occupy these young people's mind, as well as adults, to separate us from God, mm-hmm. How do we have the table in the community 24/7? Because, I mean, you talked about they come down to the school, they come to football practice, mm-hmm. You got them for that moment,
mm-hmm.
But eventually they got to go back to the wilderness.
Mm-hmm.
So how do we keep that table there where they can take it with them?
Well, that's a good question. Just me sitting in the room with you with the Pathfinders, that is a table.
Yes, it is.
You understand? That you create that table, that's a table. That kid or that person that you did, that brotherhood that y'all have, to help them to know how to fight that off when they leave out. That's how Lakeland is coming together. They set tables like that inside of this school. You understand? That's how we deal with that. And you have to teach the core values that was taught at the table. That's what people don't understand in all the schools, all the schools in all these different communities. You have to set that in the high school. Ginn Academy is a table. You understand? I went down to, and I'm gonna tell you, and sometimes I do some crazy stuff. The mayor was awarding me the key, I think, to the city, you know? It's funny, but it's not funny. You know what I'm saying? I say, well, you gave me this key. I don't know what I can open up with it. Yes, Dad. So I said, you know, it's a lot of things that's going on. I say, you know, I appreciate the award and stuff like that. I say, but we're losing our communities. You understand? Because we don't have enough tables set in our communities, meaning in the schools, in the community, the girls and boys clubs, this, that. All these different things are examples of tables, and we all should be teaching the same thing that we're missing in our homes. And that goes for everybody. I say, but because if the only place we can make a difference in the world is, once again, through school, church, and coaching, and that's the way we make a difference. I say, think about this, how important the table was. And you go back to 1963, or 1962, one or two, when they had, I had a dream speech, Martin Luther King on Washington, D.C., on the steps of Washington, D.C. Back then, we didn't have a cell phone. We didn't have Twitter. We didn't have an internet. Some people didn't even have phones. No radio, nothing. You understand? 250,000 people across the country end up on the steps of Washington, D.C. to hear that speech. That had to be discussed at the table and passed through your churches. What happened? So these are the things that is missing. You understand? And we have to create these tables all over the world and teach the core values of life.
How did you start your academy? Like were you in school? Are you still a coach at Glenville?
Yes.
And you have the academy. So that is like a separate entity from your coaching position. And is that an after school thing?
Yes.
And do you handpick the members, or they come to you?
No.
So I guess my question towards your academy is, how can we make your academy nationwide? How can we make people understand that it's about the individual? It's not about It's not about the cream of the crop.
No, it's not.
Right.
Because it's about the foundation.
Right.
You know, you have to build your foundation. Otherwise, there is no.
That's right.
There is no top of the mountain.
Right. That's the question that I ask all the time. You know, people know right from wrong. People know what's working and what's not working.
Wisdom, right?
You know, the wisdom and sometimes people don't want to fix things. You know, why is that? You know, because it's money and dysfunction.
That's right.
You know, and right don't always make money.
I'm sorry to interrupt.
Go ahead. I'm just.
And it's the power too.
Yeah.
They don't want to relinquish the power that they gain.
You know, it's hard to say. I mean, it's not hard for me, but if it's not your idea, it's not right.
Yeah.
You know, it's just so simple, man, we make it complicated. And, you know, it's sad because I'm not just sitting here talking to you just to be talking to you with a speech or something like that. I'm talking about real, true stuff that I deal with every day, no matter who it is, no matter where you come from. I got kids that, and family members and friends that's black and white, that I talk with their kids in all parts of this city and this around here. And it's just basic stuff that their kids are missing. And we talk about giving our kids an opportunity. They're not gonna give our kids an opportunity. What was wrong in 1974 when a kid could go to school? If he wanted to go to college, he had a pathway to do that. If he wanted to go in the workforce, he had a pathway to do that. If he wanted to go into construction, he could do that. If he wanted to be a carpenter, he could do that. He could, whatever they wanted to do. They start taking these things out. And then now, after 20 years later, we can't find nobody in the workforce. What you talking about? You the one screwed it up. We was talking about this years. I've been talking about this for 25 years. And now all of a sudden, the kids don't know what a screwdriver is. Yeah, that person wasn't important then. And you putting all of us in a situation of education. That was education when you could go to the Ford Motor Company and the Chevy plant and to be a carpenter or a mechanic. That was education. That's what we chose, you know? But now everybody, you can't take a industry town like Cleveland and make it a professional town like New York or Washington, D.C. and then tell us we not educated. Come on, man. And now the world is upside down and everybody looking around, we got a problem. Yeah, we sure do. You know, but man, you know, it's tough, man. It's a tough business. And it's so tough, man, because I deal with it every day. I'm just not sitting here with this shirt and tie on for nothing. You know, I'm out here fighting every day because everybody in this room is at risk. If we don't change, we got a problem. And the kids don't know how to deal with it because we're so concentrating on so much of what your test score is. Old folks used to tell us, you go down to that school, this is how this country talk now. You understand? Country folks. They say, go down to that schoolhouse and learn that schoolhouse stuff, but you better learn how to do something. I didn't even understand that then. That means you better come back here and pick this cotton and feed them chickens and milk them cows, because we're going to have to eat in a minute. And shell them peas. Yes, there. See, it's a whole terminology in all parts of the world. And I was laughing with him when he said, hey, man, I know what you're talking about. You're talking about shell. See, everybody here don't know what shell the peas. Your hands be this sore. And hey, I used to get plenty of whoopings about that. Because if I didn't shell them peas and I was too busy playing, when grandmama came home from the field, we didn't have nothing to eat, so I'm finna get the dust knocked out of my pants.
I have a question.
Yes.
You talked about dysfunction is a moneymaker. What do you think about this prison system?
What I think about it?
Yeah.
Moneymaker. They said of the prison, this is just crazy. And I talk about this all the time. In the city, right in the heart of the inner city, you said a big $1 million jail. So what kind of example is that for the kids that live on the street here? This is where you're supposed to be. It's a moneymaker. They know how to stop crime. They know how to do everything. You know, but it don't make money. I mean, it makes too much money. They know a third grader, if he don't pass the OGT now, but they got a new test called what? Smart or something? They just come up with that. You know, I don't care nothing about no tests. You understand? Because this world go test you for real when you get out here. That test they talking about, you better act like you know it. It's just a requirement. But they know from a third grader where you're headed. That's just people sitting down, coming up with all this data, coming up and they say, well, research says by the time he's 18, he'll be doing 30 years. We can make all that money, invest your money over here. It's a scheme.
I think what that guy really wants to know, tell him about your struggles to even get that school open. Tell him what you had to do.
Mm-hmm. You said the struggle?
I said, tell him your struggles about, he wants to know how you got that school open.
Boy, anybody got pads in here? We got to see who the leak in the system around here. Because if I really tell you, we have a problem.
Yeah.
Everybody come looking for me. Well, man, it's not easy. You know, no, it's not. You know, and you try to be politically correct in everything you do. But I think I can tell you so much, man. How can I tell these people that? Lord, come and help me tell this. Well, I think, let me put it to you like this. I think that sometimes I feel like in the beginning, they said, this dude got an ideal. But, you know, he's doing so much in the community and he's helping kids over here. That's one or two, three or four. You know, he want to think he can help a lot, you know, so. And then the pressure came from the media and from people in the community. So let him do what he do. So, you know, I think I kind of got shamed into giving me the school and hoping that I fail when I first.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
You know, I mean, you know, I'm trying to be right. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Man, you taping this. But, you know, I'm just trying to, and I think that some kind of way it exploded and became real successful. And it's still a struggle. You know, I'm facing things today. I sit in a lot of meetings and like I say, if it's not their idea, it don't make sense. And you know, the ability to influence people is a huge gift. And God has blessed me to do that, and I try to get people around me to help. But I'm still struggling with that. I'm dealing with something now that my graduation rate is 95%. And that might be the worst thing that I could have done. And then I always tell people, I apologize for the 5. You know? And I think that's the worst thing that I could have done, to have an average of 95% graduation rate. And now I'm dealing with, well, because I go ask, we need more and more for our kids. And that's everybody in the world. Now the thing that I'm dealing with is that, yeah, he do a great job of getting them to school. He do a great job of graduating. They're doing a great job. See, first of all, you can't graduate if you don't have great test scores. You know what I'm saying? So we're doing a great job. Now, they're not good. They're not making it into society. Where do you get that research from? How can you tell what kid leave Ginn Academy and what he become? So I'm dealing with that now because I'm asking for money to do more. I think that we should have an inner city boarding school. I think that every kid needs to stay there all week to knock off that negativity and that hopelessness that they walk into every day, that you have to keep every day be consistent. No, don't pay attention to that. You can really do this. You can do it. That's the reason they need to live there. And when I ask them about that, they tell me, oh no, we don't believe in, why would we put $50 million in building up the community and housing and schools and different things like that, and have the kids living there so that we can really pour it in and teach them and set that table. You understand? They don't want that. So they come up with all of these different terminologies that they think go over my head, and they don't. I'm just asking you real stuff. Y'all know what we're dealing with. So it's still a struggle. But I'm gonna keep fighting. Because I'm gonna tell you, I'm not gonna give up. I'm not gonna rust out. I just might give out, but I'm not gonna rust out, so I'm gonna keep moving.
All right. Got one more question over here?
Dave.
Yeah, Teddy, it's something I've been around your place a long time, and something that I've seen watch. I was watching a nice thing on St. Benedict's Academy, and I see a lot of parallels as I've watched you grow through the years. And they have very similar things, and something that you can expand on for them, I won't talk too much on it, is I've seen your mentorship programs from kid to kid, starting way back even when your son was there, and that football team, and you know, there's always a lot of negativity around your success. You and I both know that. But as I watched Junior, Troy, grabbing kids to make sure they had their eligibility cards in that day, you weren't doing it, coaches weren't doing it, they were grabbing kids and scolding them.
Right.
Like it was their little brother.
That's right.
You know what I mean? Kids teaching kids. Mm-hmm. It was a fascinating thing to watch, and you gonna actually call you to tell you to watch this thing on St. Benedict's if you can see it. They actually go by the Boy Scout model. Mm-hmm. Everything that they came up with is really Boy Scouts, and it's fascinating. But there's a lot of parallels. So just something that I think everyone could get out of this real quick is you talking about you teaching kids to teach kids to keep kids in line. It's more than just adults in these schools. The ones that are successful, I see the same thing. These young men know that from my coaching, I was trying to get kids to coach kids.
Right.
I think the minute a kid starts coaching a kid, it crystallizes for him what you were saying. And there's sometimes you'll watch a kid and you'll think, he's not listening to me. You know, you just told him something 30 times. But the minute he becomes responsible for a younger man to teach him, all of a sudden you see him teaching the things that you think he never
taught.
That's right.
And it's a fascinating process to watch. And really, like I said, I've watched you bring this into your academy since from the early days in Glenville. So I think that's something you could expand on.
Yeah, I always tell kids, you know, every kid, that there's always somebody looking at you that want to be like you. So you have to be the example for the next guy. That's that brotherhood situation. And and like I said, once again, the kid got to see what you're talking about. So the person that you put in front of them had already done it. So that's how you keep building as you go along, is that brotherhood. I know that.
Yes. Okay, I interviewed for a job at Ginn Academy. I taught in Cleveland. I taught 40 years in Mentor, and then I went to Cleveland because I wanted a challenge, okay? Mm-hmm. And I interviewed to teach at Ginn Academy, and it was a really bad experience, one of the worst I think I've ever had. However, I was then relegated because I had no seniority because I'd been out here to substituting, and I substituted at Ginn Academy. And it was awesome. It was the best job I ever had because they say the kids ignore a substitute, but boy, you learn a lot about the school, and I learned that and I felt that way anyway, that's why I applied. Mm-hmm. But no one ever understood me, except in Mentor. Anyway, I just understood, and I could see the kids helping each other, the kids making sure that everything got done, talking to each other, when they catch up with you, you don't got to wear a uniform, whatever. The kids dealt with each other. Mm-hmm. It was the most awesome experience I had in the Cleveland Public Schools.
Great.
Well,
hats off to you, every school.
Great.
So be that way. I promise you, you're doing it the right way.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I'm going to publicly apologize because we didn't get you as a teacher. I must not have been on the interview board.
I was also, by the way, I taught at Glenville and respected you 100% there.
Oh, man. I know you look familiar, though. And you got on that right color. You got that cardinal on your. Dave got all these cardinals in here. That's when I don't play Mentor.
But thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes.
And you know, all you hear about is all they had a fight after you.
Yeah.
I'll bet you that was dealt with beautifully, too.
Oh, no question.
You don't hear. Everybody should go to your school and spend a day.
That's right. Yeah, come unannounced. Cause I said, come unannounced. You don't have to say, can I get an appointment? I want you to see it for real.
Well, why don't you put that word out?
Oh, it
maybe
did.
Maybe then you get further in Cleveland.
Yeah, well,
I don't know the right people the day I interviewed, and neither did the person after me. He was even in there shorter time. And both of us worked together at East High School. So we had the toughest.
But you know, you probably was there when I had those bad principals too. I'm just trying to tell you, because I went through about three principals till I got who I got today, because they didn't have love for kids.
Absolutely. That was so evident in that interview.
And yeah.
In fact, I laughed once, and the guy next to me interviewed says, was I laughing? I said, yes, sir. And then they said something else, and I guffawed a little, you know, he said, was that a guffaw? And I said, yes. And I knew then I might as well not call that. Had the same situation, and we taught together, and we were friends with these guys.
Okay.
All right. Hats off to you. You're doing it the right way.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
After 55 years,
right.
I know that.
Right.
Okay, so we're going to. Thank you. We're going to do, we just have a little token of appreciation for Coach Ginn and a presentation also. From Dr. Motley. Dr. Motley, who's representing the NAACP in Lake County, but he has a presentation for you from the Lake County Commissioner's Office.
Thank you.
First of all, it is an honor to be able to stand before you. Not only am my name Dr. Motley, but I'm also Director of Religious Affairs for the Lake County NAACP. But when I was asked to come and give this young man an award, I was elated. I was happy. I said, yes! I see, we are former alumni. I am also a tar blooder.
Oh.
From Glenville, 1965.
I heard that mileage. I know about the mileage.
But Coach Ginn, he did tell you one thing, and I want you to remember that. No matter who you are or where you go, an education is an education. It's what you make of it. Quick example, my daughter went to Harvey High School in Painesville, not rated as high as Riverside, but she took all honor courses. She got a 3.78 acume. She went to Case Western Reserve, got her master's in 6 years. So perseverance is what it's all about.
That's right.
See, you have to want it. They can't keep you from getting it. You have to want it. And if you want it, you'll get it. Look at me. I got it. I came from Glenville,
right.
Straight out of the hood, down there off 105.
Yeah.
A whole lot of people came out from down there. But look at us. We're successful. The doors were closed, but like he said, key word, God opened them up. Look at us now.
That's right.
All praise be unto God. Thank you. Mr. Ginn.
As a fellow young
man. Yeah.
Bless you.
Bless you too.
Thank you.
Yes.
It's an honor.
Don't sit down. Oh, don't sit down.
Don't sit down.
Hey, you know, I follow orders now.
Don't sit down.
Okay.
I'm going to read you the wording so you'll know exactly what he's getting. The Board of Commissions, Lake County. Certificate of Recognition, April 14, 2016. Honoring Theodore Ginn Sr. for his dedicated leadership. Whereas Ted Ginn Sr. was raised with a strong Christian background, a foundation instilled upon him by his grandparents as a young boy. This foundation has served him well as he coaches and mentors to young men of Glenville High School and the Ginn Academy. Authored inspirational books and continued to present motivational speeches nationally and. Whereas Ted Ginn Sr. founded the Ginn Academy in 2007, which provides its approximately 350 vibrant and culturally diverse young men with a rich academic, social, and athletic environment in which to not only learn, grow, and choose vocations, but also to cultivate a perceptive rooted in virtues that will serve as the foundation to become the responsible citizens of the world. And now, therefore, we, the Board of Commissioners in and of Lake County, Ohio, do hereby extend our genuine gratitude to Ted Ginn Sr. for his significant commitment and passion to his faith, to the youth, to the athletes, and the educational system, and commend his personal contributions to the greater purpose, and wish him continued success, prosperity, and fulfillment in the future. May God bless you, Mr. Ginn.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
God bless you.
God bless you.
I'll talk to you later.
Bye bye.
I want to do one other real quick presentation. This is for Miss Hazel Parker, who's been so instrumental in helping us. This is Coach Ginn's administrative assistant, who also went to school with us, Glenville Tarbletter, and just all the help that you've been with helping put this together. And that's the end of the program. We do have a reception afterwards outside. And thanks again for all of you coming and participating in this.
All right.